Good afternoon. My name is Jennifer Wong, and I'm the president of the IMSA Student Council. On behalf of the Illinois Mathematics and Science Academy, I'd like to welcome our guests and the IMSA community to the 7th Annual James R. Thompson Leadership Lecture. The Academy's foundation, the IMSA Fund for Advancement of Education, is happy to provide this opportunity for students and teachers from throughout Illinois to enjoy an afternoon on the IMSA campus listening to world-renowned speakers such as Mr. Burke. We are glad to have you here on campus, and we hope that you learn more about the work of the Academy, and of course, science, from your visit. We have all looked forward to this day for some time now, and I know we will enjoy the lecture. At this time, I would like to introduce the President of the Academy, Dr. Stephanie Pace Marshall.
Thank you, Jen, and good afternoon to all of you. On behalf of the Board of Trustees, the faculty, staff, and students of the Illinois Mathematics and Science Academy, welcome to the Academy and to the 7th Annual James R. Thompson Leadership Lecture. I want to echo Jen's welcome and say what a real pleasure it is for us to have all of you here this afternoon. We welcome you as partners and friends. Without your continued support, events like this simply would not be possible. Unfortunately, Governor Thompson, the man in whose honor this lecture was established, is not able to be with us this afternoon. However, he did ask me to offer a warm welcome to all of you on his behalf and to tell you that he would indeed be with us in spirit. So, in the spirit of Jim Thompson, I welcome you all. At this time, I'd also like to recognize some special guests of IMSA who are here today. We are pleased to welcome several members of the Illinois General Assembly, in addition to over 400 teachers and students from Illinois schools, many of whom are partners with IMSA in a variety of service programs. We also, of course, welcome our members of the Board of Trustees, members of the Board of Directors of the IMSA Fund, and several local government officials. And finally, we are delighted to welcome our corporate foundation and individual donors to the IMSA Fund of Advancement of Education. We continue to thank you for your generous support. Each year, as Jen said, this remarkable lecture enables us to invite distinguished leaders in the sciences and the humanities to our campus. We were very fortunate to have the late Dr. Carl Sagan at our inaugural lecture 6 years ago. And in subsequent years, we've heard from renowned leaders such as Dr. Edward Teller, Dr. Maya Angelou, Dr. Sally Ride, and Captain Jim Lovell. Last year, as many of you know, at our 10th anniversary celebration, we were honored with the presence of IMSA's founding fathers, Leon Letterman and James Thompson. As we embark on our second decade and continue our work in Illinois, the visionary leadership of our many boards becomes increasingly important. That is why we are so fortunate today to have Bill White serving as the Vice President of the Board of Directors of the IMSA Fund for Advancement of Education. We could think of no one more appropriate than Mr. White to introduce our speaker today. As chairman of Bell & Howell Company, Mr. White understands the critical need for transforming the way students learn and teachers teach science. Every day of every year, Bell & Howell is faced with the challenge and opportunity of transforming products and services so that they will continue to be a leader in their industry. Mr. White has shared his time and knowledge with others in many, many ways. Not only is he vice president of our fund, but he also serves as chairman of the advisory council of the McCormick School of Engineering and Applied Sciences at Northwestern. He is also past chairman of the Illinois Division of the American Cancer Society and has been an adjunct professor at Northwestern, as well as a visiting lecturer at the Darden School of the University of Virginia and the University of Illinois in Chicago. With an undergraduate degree in industrial engineering from Northwestern and an MBA from Harvard, Bill's background has much in common with many of you in our audience today. In light of his past accomplishments, his present involvement, his leadership for the future, and his championship of the Illinois Math and Science Academy, I'd like to ask you to join me in welcoming one of today's great leaders, Mr. Bill White, who will introduce our speaker.
Thank you. Thank you very much. And thank you, Stephanie, for that nice introduction. It's indeed a privilege for me and really a pleasure to introduce our speaker for the 7th annual James R. Thompson Leadership Lecture. Award-winning television host, best-selling author, educator, world-renowned lecturer, James Burke was born in Northern Ireland and educated at Jesus College, Oxford. Upon leaving Oxford, Mr. Burke taught at the universities of Bologna and Urbino, Italy, and was director of the English School at Urbino and at Rome. Mr. Burke anchored all of the BBC's coverage of the Apollo moon flights, and from 1972 through 1979, he produced, wrote, and presented the weekly primetime one-man science show, The Burke Special. Now that, for those of you that live in the United States and are old as I am, remember Mr. Wizard. He was the Mr. Wizard of England in those days. Okay? For which this show, he received the Royal Television Society's silver and gold medals for excellence in television. Now, Mr. Burke's fascination with technology and its impact on society led in 1979 to the highly acclaimed prize-winning series, Connections, a 10-part science history series that was filmed in over 19 countries in 150 locations. The program took a series of seemingly unrelated events, people, and situations and fit them into a puzzle that helped explain the fundamental process of social and technological change. As Mr. Burke notes, and I quote, "There's always a connection, but if the link has never been made, no one knows it's there." And students here understand that because this series is used at IMSA as a piece of our instructional curriculum. Now, he has said that education itself will need to change. Schools and universities will need to replace their outdated, reductionist forms of learning with the cross-disciplinary knowledge necessary for riding the information networks of the future. We will primarily need to take a new attitude, he says, to the matter of intelligence and qualification. Just as Gutenberg's Bible brought the need to be able to read, the new systems will require the ability to navigate the network rather than to know things, to be able to retrieve data rather than to remember it. A lifelong qualification in a single discipline will be meaningless, and along with it will go the habit by which people characterize themselves according to the job they do. Close quote. Now lastly, I'm not sure what Mr. Burke is going to talk about today, and you will have a chance to ask him questions afterwards, but he may tell you why 19th century citizens opposed painting numbers on their houses. He may tell you why icons may replace words. May tell why electronic commerce will eliminate the use of currency and coins. He may talk about wideband electronic access, which will truly change all of your lives. Currently, Burke is creating a 10-part television series entitled Journeys on the Web for Discovery Communications, and that's one of the reasons he's in the United States this week. We're truly honored to have such an insightful, creative, innovative man to share with us here to share with us today. I know that his words will leave a lasting impression on all of us. I think you're really in for a treat. So please join me in welcoming our esteemed guest and our speaker, Mr. James Burke. He's put away. You're welcome.
You'll be tired before I start. Thank you very much indeed for that introduction, which gave away most of what I was going to say. So you can go to sleep right now. Basically, I suppose I am an historian turned journalist, really. That's like being a gamekeeper turned poacher. And just so that you don't take too seriously what I say today, let me begin by reminding you of something the late, great Mark Twain once said, when he might have been talking about people like me, when he said, in the real world, the right thing never happens in the right place at the right time. It is the task of journalists and historians to rectify this error. So basically what I'm going to do is a little rectification on the subject of what we usually take to be the process of change and why it does what it does to us and we to it. Now, since this is going at some point to involve taking a risk and doing a bit of prediction, let me say something about prediction. It ain't easy. They say, don't they, that things change so fast these days, by the time you read the manual, there's been an upgrade. I keep on not buying a laptop for this, exactly that reason. And the attitude of most ordinary people in the street to what science and technology is doing to them, and that means one day what people like you will be doing to them, always reminds me of the attitude of the depressive who's getting treated, and he gets a couple of days off to go, you know, away for a few days rest, goes to the beach to get himself a tan. 2 days later, his psychiatrist back in the clinic gets a postcard. And the message on the postcard, I feel, is very typical of people like depressives and the average person in the street facing the avalanche of change that hits them every day, because the message on the card reads, having a wonderful time, why? Most people, in other words, when faced with what you're going to be doing to their lives, just give up. Mainly, as I hope to show here today, because most of us are living in the 21st century with a 19th century attitude. But before I get too serious, let me remind you, talking about prediction, about what the great Danish physicist Niels Bohr once said about it. He said, prediction is extremely difficult, especially about the future. Danish joke. But I think his point was really that when you're trying to predict what science and technology are going to do, indeed anything from the outcome of an experiment to who's going to win, I believe, a rather important ball game quite soon, or rather football game, you're always working within the limitations of what you think you know. And that can sometimes lead you up the garden path. Take, for example, the case of the average medieval man in the street who would have fallen off his bar stool laughing at the concept that one day in the far distant future, our world, every individual member of society would have their own individual form of transportation to go where they chose, when they chose. And he would have fallen off his bar stool laughing at that because, of course, that he would have been thinking of the concept of those distant cities in the future coming to a total standstill, as of course they would, when every street was 14 feet deep in horse dung. Now, this problem with forecasting was once rather neatly handled by the great modern philosopher Wittgenstein. Wittgenstein ruined lives for teachers, by the way, because it was he who said, if anything can be said at all, it can be said clearly. Anyway, just lost some friends there. Somebody once went up to Wittgenstein once and said, what a bunch of morons we Europeans must have been back in the days before Copernicus told us how the solar system worked, to have looked up in the sky and to have thought that what we were seeing up there was the sun going round the earth, when, as any idiot knows, the earth goes round the sun, and you don't have to be Einstein to understand that. To which the great philosopher is said to have said, yeah, yeah, as philosophers will do. I said, but I wonder what it would have looked like up there if the sun had been going round the earth. Point being, of course, it would have looked exactly the same. What Wittgenstein was saying was that your view of what's what, including your view, of course, of the future, and the business of change, is always constrained by the knowledge that you're working with at the time. So is there any difficulty around this? Is there any way around this little difficulty we seem to be having with crystal balls? Well, I think one thing is sure. The only place to look for the answer to the future is the past. That's why history is valuable, because if you think about it, there is nowhere else to look. The future has this unnerving habit of never happening. A word or two about what could be a very useful tool when handling this problem. It's something that everybody has, and it's probably the greatest futurist on the planet. It's called the human brain. And let me take size for a start. Rough guess, it's about 100 billion neurons, each one of which is able to make contact with a colossal number of others. So the combined or combinatorial or whatever you want to call it, a potential number of ways in which what we describe as a thought can go through that whole mess is, I believe, larger than the number of atoms in the known universe. Makes the internet look kind of small, doesn't it? And while I'm on the humongous and how clever the brain is, it is worth noting, if you're ever feeling stupid, that the combined capabilities of all the supercomputers in the world add up to the cognitive abilities of a sea slug. So what we have in here is a system that is so gigantic it ought to make mincemeat of simple stuff like the prediction of change. So why doesn't it? Well, I think partly because we've taught ourselves not to use the brain the way in which it was designed to be used, probably because of the overwhelming importance to those guys back in the caves of the linear bit-by-bit process of making flint axes. And then later on, the incredible success of the alphabet, which is linear and bit-by-bit, as a result of which we now prize above all the logical mind and downgrade the intuitive. We strongly favor the reductionist view, the take it apart and you'll see how it works approach that René Descartes came up with about 400 years ago and that is really fundamentally responsible for all the science and technology around. Now, I'm not knocking science and technology. I'd be foolish in a place like this. And I love it when all the bits of my airplane work, yes. But think for a second about what else the brain does besides bit-by-bit linear thinking. Every zillionth of a second, it's running scenarios. Now that is why you're understanding me now. I don't mean that you understand the funny way I talk. It should be noticed that as far as I'm concerned, you're the ones with the accent. I mean you're understanding me in this sense. If what you were doing was hearing every phoneme, every sound that I uttered, and you went into some kind of lexicon, dictionary thing in your head, and went from top to bottom to identify the sound you just heard, then put it on the end of the string of sound you just heard before that, saw that it made sense and came back and listened for the next one, then at 1 millisecond per act of neural retrieval, it would be taking you, let's say if you were accessing the average high school graduate's vocabulary of 12,500 words, it would be taking you 12.5 seconds to recognize each sound I uttered. And you're not doing that, are you? Good. So what are you doing? You're running scenarios. You're powering up all the possible ways I might finish each sound or phrase or sentence or paragraph, given what's gone before. And then as I come on through, powering down the ones you got wrong and powering up the next set of alternates and going on doing that for as long as I continue to make sounds up here on the stage. And of course, in one sense, what that means is that you are all giving this speech before I am. And all other speeches I might have given. One wonders why you came. Now, maybe one of the reasons we find forecasting so hard to do is because we suppress that every which way thing that goes on in the brain. In spite of the fact that the process of change itself seems to defy sequentiality in the every which way that change happens. Let me try and show you just how non-linear the process of change is by taking you on a journey, whizzing about on what you might call the great web of knowledge. A journey, I think, could well be one of the kinds of educational and training processes offered in sometime in the not-too-distant future. Now, as I go along, if you want to, you stick to logic and see if you get there ahead of me. See how many times it's easier for you to get the next fork before I do in the road. Now, for my starting point on this journey around the web of knowledge, I have chosen a major, important, meaningful, technological masterpiece from the modern world, the toilet roll. The other toilet roll. TV training. All right, here goes. Now, the concept of this roll of paper in its particular modern world environment is unthinkable without the entire waste management system running beneath the streets of every city, pretty much in the Western world. A relatively new phenomenon in its modern form, and which first saw the light of day, thanks to the incredibly awful conditions, sanitary conditions, of the 19th century Industrial Revolution towns. So all over the place, they dug up the streets and the pavements in order to lay down the first sewage systems in the east coast of America and in London before anywhere else. Now, the reason they did this was because of the great cholera epidemics of the last century, which killed hundreds of thousands of people, both in Europe and on the east coast here. Now, that this cholera should have occurred at all was probably to do with a tremendous surge in the growth of the population of these industrial towns once James Watt did his thing and made industrialization possible and factories making everything from soup to nuts. Now, it only took a few years of refinement before James Watt's steamy little steam pump was sitting on wheels and moving along in a thing we were calling a locomotive, and especially in the West, in the United States, opening up the West, on single tracks, because if you think about it, that's half the cost of double tracks, isn't it? The minor problem about single tracks is how do you tell me that you're coming? This thought occurred to a few people after some spectacular Casey Jones-type crashes, brought this minor discrepancy to even the dullest intellect, like that of Sam Morse, who solved the problem with the telegraph around 1841, which is really all the telegraph is originally designed to do. Morse did his thing, of course, because of the availability of a fairly regular supply of electricity, and as always, people are trying, when there's plenty of something around, people try it with many things. 19th century electricity was supposed to cure infertility. It was tried as a form of religion. It was tried with explosives and skin cures, and of course, people shoved electricity like mad into the vacuum to see what would happen, which led to, you know, cathode rays and then subatomic particles, from which it was a relatively small step to a relatively large bang. Hiroshima is the word that floats to mind. That is, of course, if you could do the math to work out how to make it happen. Since the matter of imploding a lump of uranium with the astonishing precision you need to get a bang isn't that easy. And back in the 1940s, during World War II, by the most amazing coincidence, there was a means to do these calculations thanks to the small matter of Adolf Hitler and the V2 Wonder rocket weapon, Vengeance Weapon 2, with which he was reducing my early childhood to heaps of rubble. V2 weapons were causing artillery people terrible problems because back in 1942, to hit one was taking an average of 10,000 artillery shells, conspicuous expenditure equaled perhaps only by your deficit. Now, this little hit-and-miss problem was probably the main reason why, in Philadelphia, 1943, a monster adding machine called ENIAC was being built to do all the calculations for all the things that could possibly happen to an artillery shell when you pulled the trigger and it went towards the missile. ENIAC was, of course, pretty much the first computer, and after it was finished with artillery stuff, it got hijacked by the people at Los Alamos to do that implosion modeling I was talking about. ENIAC itself, of course, owed its existence to silk weaving. Back in 1889, in Baltimore, a young fellow called Herman Hollerith was in charge of one part of the national census coming up in 1890, and he had a brother-in-law in textiles, and this guy told him about an automatic silk weaving technique. On the loom, he used to hang great big pieces of paper with holes in it. Then you push the paper up against a whole set of hooked wires. If there was a hole, the wire went through and hooked the thread, so you could plan the pattern before you actually ran the loom. What Hollerith did was to electrify the little wires and push them through holes to make a contact or not on the other side, so the hole was a piece of information for the census. Hollerith, we call that a punch card today. Hollerith went into business with a bunch of people we call today IBM. The whole paper without holes in it idea was around for Hollerith to deal with thanks to the kind of CD craze of the late Renaissance, which was automated water gardens. Water power, as you know, was the main motive source at the time, and people used it for everything, including automated music. Haydn wrote some extremely bad music for one of these things, come to think of it. Anyway, now what you did was you had pegs on a little cylinder, and as the cylinder went round, the pegs would hit little bells or open little valves in an organ or something like that, and you ran the cylinder round and round with water power. Now, to tell the guy where to put the pegs on the cylinder, you gave him a piece of paper with holes in it, and he put it round the cylinder, marked that, put the pegs there. One of these guys, one of these hydraulic guys working on these water gardens at one point was an Italian called Venturi. And obviously one of the things he had to do was to work out water metering, and he discovered if you put a kink in a water pipe, the pressure changes and the water turns to spray. Big deal, everybody said, and went back to dancing the gavotte, or whatever they were doing. Until a couple of hundred years later, the idea got snitched in operating theatres as an antiseptic technique. He's shooting a fine mist of carbolic liquid into the operating theatre, causing all surgeons at the time to say, "Let us spray." Lister was the name of the guy who did this, and the technique pretty much worked for him. And he only did it because he heard a rumor that somebody in another part of England had tried curing anthrax in cattle by dipping them into this kind of carbolic stuff. Anthrax, the problem of anthrax itself, of course, was solved in really spectacular fashion when a German experimenter, middle of the 19th century, left a petri dish with his culture out on a warm stove overnight, and for some strange reason, some of the new artificial chemical dye that had recently been discovered fell into the petri dish overnight, and when the guy goes down there in the morning, there are his bugs stained bright blue. Bingo, bacteriology. Thanks to an accident. The thing is, so had the dye been. I mean, artificial dye was discovered by this wonderful guy called William Perkin. Now, William Perkin decides to be the great British imperial hero because he's going to find artificial quinine and save all our chaps out in the colonies from dying from malaria. Well, he doesn't. He comes up with a black sludge, as it happens. It's not malaria. He throws it down the sink and discovers he's accidentally invented the world's first artificial dye. Makes a million, in typical British fashion, by selling the idea to a German. However, the reason the Brits, as I said, were concentrating on quinine was because real quinine was available out there, but it belonged to the Dutch, and typically they were charging an arm and a leg. So what the Royal Botanical Gardens in Kew in London were doing was desperately trying to grow cinchona trees from South America, because in the bark of the cinchona tree you get quinine. Well, they didn't do too well on this, but they were doing everything they could, and this is why they turned down an urgent request from a Scotsman called Mackintosh, who said, "Could we please have some botanical expeditions to go abroad and bring back rubber tree seedlings and drop this cinchona stuff?" Well, this, as I said, was not very important for the people in Kew, so they turned him down. The point was that in 1823, the Scotsman had got himself a patent for dissolving rubber and spreading it between layers of cotton and inventing what we now call the raincoat, and it's still to this day in England known as a Mackintosh. Now, because he was in the business of dyeing cloth before this, he discovered that a chemical he'd been using to clean his vats out, called naphtha, would dissolve rubber, and so he used it to invent the raincoat. That there should have been naphtha lying around for him to use was probably thanks to the new gas light everybody was turning on. Gas lamps burnt coal gas, and they did so mainly because of the failure of the bankrupt Earl of Dundonald. Now, here's a guy whose forebears have backed the wrong king or the wrong horse for so many years that he has nothing left but a couple of tin pot coal mines and a few mangy cows. So he thinks up a real wheeze to recoup the family fortunes. What he's going to do is going to burn his coal, or rather cook his coal in a kiln, and get the black gunk that comes out from the bottom of it and sell it to the British Navy. The point being, ever since you people left us after that entirely regrettable matter in 1776, there was nothing wrong with taxation without representation. You think you don't have it today? Anyway. Now, the point about Dundonald's gunk was he'd put it on the bottom of the ships that would protect the ships from little beetles that used to, you know, screw their way into the hulls and the ship would sink. Well, what we were really trying to do was come over here and exploit you colonists. So anyway, he goes to the British Navy and he says, "Here's my gunk," and they say, "Sorry, we don't do it that way anymore," and that's that. He happens to mention that when he's cooking his coal, fumes come off that you can set light to his pal James Watt, some pal. A few years later, James Watt, quote, invents coal gas, unquote. But the gunk is called coal tar, and in the early 1800s, thanks to gaslight manufacturer, there is more of it you can throw away, which they are doing. They're dumping it in every river, which is why Mackintosh's naphtha was free, and that's why he did what he did. Meanwhile, coal gas itself was an accident waiting to happen. Frequently, pretty much everywhere, factories, homes, shops, theatres, would go up in flames for obvious reasons. So when boring, self-promoting Thomas Edison decided that he was going to solve this problem with a different kind of light, and came up with a way of burning a filament in a vacuum in a light bulb, he changed the world. But not in the way you might think I mean. Not light, radio. Because one day, Edison noticed that one of his light bulbs was kind of smutty. And on investigation, it was revealed that what was happening was that the filament was setting off particles that were charging down and hitting the base plate and making the marks. He did nothing about it except, of course, being him, patent the idea, right? No fool. A few years later, a fellow called Lee DeForest picked up this idea and used that stream of particles to boost very tiny radio signals, thus making radio possible. In the early days, this radio, of course, got used primarily for ship-to-shore, since if you tie a cable to a ship that's crossing the Atlantic, you need one hell of a length of cable. Anyway, in the 1930s, an AT&T engineer called Jansky was asked to solve the problem which was plaguing ship-to-shore radio, which was static all the time. And he discovered the static was coming from somewhere up there. A few years later, a fellow called Raber in Wheaton, Illinois, built an antenna of chicken wire, put it on, I think, a Model T wheel, and discovered that this static was not just coming from somewhere up there, it was coming from all over up there. Radio astronomy was born, and then, of course, with it, the Big Bang, because in the 60s, a couple more Americans noticed that what was happening was that the static was, in fact, being given off, it was a signal given off by an incredibly low level of heat, around, more or less everywhere in the universe, indicating the kind of temperature you'd get if it had been cooling down for about 10 billion years. So the static was a kind of echo of the explosion of the Big Bang. Now, that meant if you could get something up there above the atmosphere, like Hubble, you might be able to look far enough out to see far enough back to the beginning. One of the early scientific reasons for rockets, the other, of course, as I mentioned, being Hitler trying to kill me. Now, these rockets have only been able to get up there thanks to the way rocket fuel gases like hydrogen oxygen go bang very efficiently. And they do that thanks to an American doctor in Apalachicola, Florida, a fellow called John Gorrie. Back in the early 19th century, he decided that if he squeezed air and it got hot, and then he released it, you know the trick, and it drops its temperature, and he surrounded it with the jacket with a jacket of seawater, this stuff, the heat would seep out into the seawater, and the air would get very cold, and it would come out very, very cold and cure his patients, because he thought malaria was caused, by the way, this meant that he had invented effectively refrigeration, because he thought malaria was caused by hot weather. He said, nobody in Boston gets malaria, and almost everybody in Apalachicola does. So he was a weather freak. Now, everybody was, actually, back then, because the Crimean War saw the destruction of a gigantic Allied fleet and encouraged everybody to try and see if they could forecast the weather. And so, after a short period of time, nuts of all kinds were standing up mountains looking at all kinds of weather. One of them was a little fellow called C.T.R. Wilson, who was so whatever that his friends and everybody else called him C.T.R. Anyway, he decided to make himself a little machine to see how clouds worked. And it essentially was a piston, a cylinder with a piston, you pull the piston down, a vacuum forms, a low pressure forms, and little clouds form inside his little gizmo. One day, just to see if he's right, he decides, since he thinks clouds are formed on dust particles, he sweeps it, as it were, electrically to get rid of the dust, and all of a sudden he sees that these things are still happening. He waves this at a fellow called Rutherford, who says, "My God, your clouds are forming on subatomic particles," and the next step, of course, was splitting the atom. As a result of which things went extremely subatomic all over the place. People tried to find these mysterious particles, whatever they were, and among these people were several trying to do it, as I said earlier, with a vacuum. And strangely enough, for a story that whizzed by a few seconds ago past James Watt and the steam pump, that's how the vacuum was originally found. Back in the 17th century, for some mysterious reason, nobody could get water up further than 30 feet. Serious matter when you're down further than 30 feet. And the net result of that, as you know, was atmospheric pressure and the vacuum and so on. The reason they were down there was because of the latest high-tech wonder weapon called a cannon. And around 1580, when somebody came up with a micro cannon that you could pick up and pull the trigger on, the army types of Europe took to the idea with all the abandon of an alcoholic in a brewery. One of these guys, Prince Maurice of Nassau in Holland, got very worried about how long it was taking his musketeers to load and fire, during which time they got killed. So Maurice came up with a great idea, loading and firing by numbers. Front row fires, step back to reload, the next lot step forward to fire, they step back to reload. And so there was never a moment when there was not a stream of hot lead going towards the enemy, so he tended to win. This doing it by the numbers trick became known as military drill. Now, if you think about what breaking something down to its smallest components, so each action can be done separately, you'll know where the idea led. The production line. I mean, within 100 years, the making of muskets had been reduced to a matter of doing each separate little bit done by different people. The real geniuses in doing this with other things were in Cincinnati, some meat packers called Smith and Armour, who hung up hogs from hooks and then moved them along in a belt, and each worker took a bit of the hog off, just that bit. They claimed, what was the phrase, "We use everything except the grunt." Of course, these food packers would have got nowhere without a French guy called Appert, whose job was bottling champagne. Some years earlier, in 1810, he came up with an idea for preserving food by putting in a champagne bottle and boiling it, and killing the germs that he didn't know existed, which caused putrefaction. By mid-19th century, people were doing the same thing but doing it in cans, because somebody in England had bought the patent and happened to own a tin-making company. And it's interesting that these people who went to buy the patent in France came back with another patent which they came across quite accidentally and which nobody seemed to want to use in France. It was a patent for continuous roll paper making that made this possible. Okay. What? Right. Where are we? In terms of upcoming information technology and their effect on us all, I think that circular journey illustrates a few points. We urgently need to teach people not to remember things, but to access and retrieve them, how to navigate the network, how to see how data relates, because the data becomes obsolete, whereas perhaps the links don't. Just as you said earlier before I started, just as after Gutenberg, we didn't teach people to bind books or print with hot metal, we taught them to read. And also, we need to teach people to think a good deal more in that every which way I described earlier, because as you've just seen, that's how change happens, and in any case, that's how the brain works. And the other reason is because, as was said before I started, being qualified for a lifetime in one single discipline is going to be useless anyway when the rates of innovation go up as fast as they will once the networks make it possible for the one thing to happen that causes change above all else. What I'm talking about is putting ideas together in ways that had never happened before, and in doing so to make one and one make three. An activity for which the brain is perfectly suited. Let me try and give you an example. That's, I think, why jokes work. If you think about it, the interconnected nature of the brain indicates, doesn't it, that something in there to do with connection is happening. Sorry about that plug. Okay. Now, if what your brain is supposed to do best is make new connections, then that's why you like jokes, because the punchline connects two things you didn't know were connected, and you laugh because your network has just been enriched. Okay, let me try it. Everybody in this room has in their model here the concept bird and the concept fruit, and like everything in the brain, it is linked in some way. Your link may be bird tree fruit, bird eat fruit, bird color fruit, I don't know. See if I can put a new one in there. If I do, you'll laugh. A drunk goes up to his host at a party and says, with all that seriousness of the totally plastered adult, "Excuse me." And the host turns around and says, "Yes," and there's a drunk swaying, glazed-eyed, you know. And the host says, "Yes, what's the problem?" And the drunk says, "There's no problem. I just wondered if you could tell me, do lemons whistle?" And the host says, "No, they don't whistle. Why do you ask?" And the drunk staggers back and smacks his forehead in chagrin and says, "Oh, my God, in that case, I have just squeezed your canary into my gin and tonic." Now, as you need a joke, all right? As I said earlier, when one and one does make three, innovation happens, and generally what follows that is an information surge. And when information surge strikes, it brings people and concepts and things together in ways that didn't happen before, and creates new entities that weren't there before. It rearranges the landscape, the social landscape, if you like. The new landscape usually begins as a modified version of the old one. I mean, cars begin by looking like buggies of the horse and buggy era. And then with luck, it becomes something in its own right. And I say with luck, because the only drag on this entire marvelous process I've been describing is the dead hand of the institution. And here's where things get screwed up. Institutions are wonderful things, and they generally come into existence when you generate a new system, like, I don't know, banking, government, the law, education, whatever, that is so good at doing what it does, you want to set the thing in concrete, so you do. Trouble is, after a while, the institution has been around for so long, you forget there was once a time and it wasn't there. You forget maybe it was originated with a specific purpose that may no longer be valid. And of course, the people running the institution are sure as hell not going to tell you about this discrepancy. I mean, their main aim in life is to keep their jobs. So in one sense, institutions, and more dangerously, institutionalized thinking, organizing, ways of solving problems, end up being there to stop anybody rocking the boat. So their presence blocks the free information flow that is essential to generating innovation. Institutions can become the embodiment of, we've always done it this way. I'm not knocking tradition and practice. We Brits put a crown on it and live off the tourist revenue. But let me give you a great example of how institutional thinking blocks change at every step of the way because of the threat which change presents to an institution or someone who thinks in that way. Take the Dark Age. After the end of the Dark Ages in Europe, the European economy kicks back into high gear, and the general idea is it's because of a new loom that comes in from the Arabs. 11th century, perhaps. And the thing about this loom is it has foot pedals, which frees up the weaver's hands to throw the shuttle back and forward, make much more cloth, much more cheaply, much more quickly. Every cloth maker in Northern Europe smashes every one of these looms they can find because they say it'll put people out of work. Remarkably modern thinking for the 11th century. However, market forces are obtained, and soon the loom is in use, and now the people making all the fuss are the thread makers. They can't make thread fast enough, until from China, unexpectedly, comes the spinning wheel, and that can make thread fast enough. You put the wheel and the loom together, and the production of cloth goes up like a rocket. More riots, this time in the very conservative woolen industry, because since the new cloth is now linen, which is made from plants, which is cheap, nobody is making enough wool from sheep, which are expensive. Still, the linen cloth is cheap, soon everybody's wearing it, and when they wear it, they throw it away. And all over Europe, there's this gigantic and growing pile of linen rag. So the price of paper drops like a stone. Linen rag is the best raw material for paper, and now it's free. More riots. Sheep farmers again. Parchment is sheepskin, and now it's too expensive to use. However, here we are with enough paper to stick on the walls, and soon enough, the well-established and old-fashioned writers' guild are on strike for higher wages because suddenly it's a seller's market for them. The Black Death has happened and knocked off one-third of the population of Europe. The other two-thirds are inheriting like crazy, and there isn't enough writing ability for all the documentation necessary. Until Gutenberg automates the process around 1450 with the printing press. Riots in that most old-fashioned of entities, the Vatican. The Pope needs a printing press like a hole in the head because it will encourage what we would now call free thinking. Until somebody in Rome recognizes that you can use the printing press to print indulgences with. Now, for those of you who are not Catholics, an indulgence was a kind of spiritual credit note. Pay now, sin later. Anyway, with all the demand for instant printed salvation that follows, Rome makes a million money to pay Michelangelo's bill, to put up the Vatican, and generally get involved in certain prestige projects that make certain German clerics madder than hell at this cash and carry view of salvation. One of whom nails up a few mild remarks on the subject, and there, thanks to advances in textile technology and fought every step of the way, is Luther, Protestantism, and the Reformation. It's a little oversimplified, but you get my drift. Institutionalized thinking doesn't like new ways of handling problems. Like the woman in the hotel elevator, a man gets in, she doesn't know, the doors close, and he says, your room or mine, baby, and she says, if you're going to argue about it, forget it. Now this is all why I think 21st century information technology is going to do things to us that are going to make everything that went before look like C-spot run. Because of what the next level of information surge will do to institutionalized thinking. To start with, in the surge of individualism that I think the new technology will generate, I would see a restructuring, if not the end, of representative democracy. I mean, if we won't take only two flavors from Baskin-Robbins, why do we accept it from Washington? American joke. All right, I won't do another one. London. I mean, if you think about representative democracy, it's a perfect solution to an 18th century problem. You live in a world with no telecommunications, with roads that are yay deep in mud, right? Lined with bushes full of bandits, and only a couple of foolhardy idiots with a horse to spare will risk the ride to the capital to represent the hayseeds. After a number of decades, these idiots become known as politicians. Okay, once they get there, because of the state of the roads and the bandits, they're not going to come down the next day and say, have you changed your minds? So infrequent return journeys are organized 3, 4, 5 years later. We now call these infrequent return journeys elections. Okay, telecommunications and aircraft and so on have made every aspect of that problem irrelevant, and yet we still have the same lumbering 18th century system. Participatory electronic democracy, which will replace it soon, will not be about two parties. It might be about 20, but it won't be about two. We cannot take on the immense individualization that's going to happen thanks to data and communications technology, without matching it with entirely new ways to run our communities in less centralized ways. We urgently need to develop an approach to dealing with knowledge that, as it were, lets everybody into the process somehow. I think interdisciplinary studies, the kind of thinking that goes on in this place, is a wonderful start. To teach people through what you might describe as journeys on the knowledge webs, that there are many ways to solve problems, many ways to think them through, and many different ways to view the world. This is already being reflected, this new kind of networked way of living, is being reflected in what telecommuting is doing to us. And pretty soon, on a global scale, it's going to do really major things to us. For example, when a manager in Boise, Idaho, is using a Japanese corporate satellite to run automated production facilities in Argentina, the way an accountant in London says a Kuwait headquarters wants, with software uplinked live from Sydney, Australia, what happens to national sovereignty? And while I'm on the global effect, perhaps the biggest effect of the coming technologies will be what they do to the company we keep. Now I know there are 5.5 billion people on this planet. When did you last hear from the other 4.9? I mean, like the kid retorts when his mother says, eat your cereal, millions are dying and starving out there. Name one. I mean, what I'm saying is that for the whole of history, we in the advanced nations have lived on a kind of silent planet. None of those illiterate peasants out there have had the means to make themselves heard. But thanks to the kind of work that you guys will be doing in a few years' time, they will have. And I don't think we're remotely prepared for what it is they have to say. But you can be pretty sure that their way of thinking isn't going to gel smoothly with ours. Now, I'm not arguing that that these people should be taking up our Western values. Just the fact that in the world of the near future, we are not going to be probably not calling the shots anymore. So in that kind of world, the wider our perspectives, the more networked our experience is, which is what I'm suggesting, the better. Why should we care? Well, when information technology and data processing make it possible for other very different cultures out there to survive and become viable and dynamic and productive in their own terms without going through westernization, then their relationship to us is not simple and economic. It's much more complicated in areas like culture and religion, ethics and morals and so on. Think of Islamic fundamentalism, just for a start. Now, that's what I meant about us not being able to handle them on their own terms without a new approach to the way we view knowledge systems other than our own. That's one of the reasons I took you on that ride on a knowledge web. I wanted to take the kind of journey that I think the training programs of the future might be taking into other people's mindsets and what they call a fact, and the way they use their values to put their world together. Again, why should we care? Well, if you look at the population forecasts for the next 50 years or so, some interesting thoughts come out. In terms of population size, for instance, today there is only one industrialized Western-type democracy in the top five, the top biggest countries in the world, five. That's you. And by 2025, you will not be. The industrialized nations, the industrialized democracies, will all be little countries in terms of numbers. The US population, for example, will be lower than that of Nigeria. Iran will be twice the size of Japan. Canada will be smaller than Madagascar. And even if industrial growth or change is slow in the third world, at that scale, any movement is going to cause mega ripples. So I think we're in for complicated times, compared with which the Cold War will seem like a picnic, because unless there are major changes in many of those countries, the liberal rule of law, human rights-oriented democratic lives that we have taken for granted in the West may end up being the exception rather than the rule. Now, in the past, of course, there was always a very simple way to deal with cultures other than your own that didn't share your values. You fired cruise missiles at them, or whatever. Thing is, of course, war happens because information systems are too limited to give you any alternative but war. As they say, limited technology, limited choice. That's why we've always run our societies top down, with leaders deciding and the rest of us slobs following along. And the more centralized the policies are, the less flexible the policies. And one day that means you end up running your country on one-liners like better dead than red, in my country right or wrong, you can have any color car you like as long as it's black. Life, however, is a great deal more complicated than the technology we've had for running it up until now, but not for much longer, I think. With what's coming, we're going to have the opposite extreme. So much freedom of movement, it's going to feel like chaos. And most countries are unprepared for that amount of freedom to make your own decisions. That's what's paralyzing places like Russia right now. And faced with this great unknown, people tend to panic. Like a phrase I saw once on a US Air Force hangar, when in danger, fear or doubt, run in circles, scream and shout. Or else people pretend it's just not there. They take this kind of leave it alone and the problem will go away approach, often described as the skyscraper mode of thinking. From the fact that this fellow falls off the top of a skyscraper. As he falls past the 77th floor, somebody calls out to ask him how he's doing. He shrugs his shoulders, by now at the 55th floor, smiles, by now at the 35th floor, and says, by now at the 25th floor, so far, so good. English joke. But this kind of attitude will not do in a world where we are no longer the only game in town, and where, like in the jungle, if you are inflexible, if you've only got one right way to do things, if you stand still for too long, then in that future jungle, sooner or later, something will eat you. I suppose the point of all this is that I think we're in for a period of complex and difficult transition from the old days of rules and regulations where everybody knew where they stood and what their place was to some kind of free-for-all. The bright spot, of course, in all this chaos is what I mentioned a while back, the fact that the brain seems to function exactly with this every which way that can handle any kind of change that's thrown at it. As long as we can persuade the institutions to train people to use their brains that way. Because what that might mean might be that the average person wouldn't need a PhD to have a say in things anymore. That we could use the virtually unlimited bandwidth to free up the billions of idiosyncratic and talented intelligences from all around the country and all around the planet, which up to now have been denied their say because they didn't fit the tests primarily designed for quill, parchment, and memory. There's a whole lot of talent out there waiting to be released in the jungles, in the inner cities, in mud hut villages, in American schools and classrooms. And the exciting thing is, I think, that technologically speaking, you Americans are probably closer than anybody else to being able to get out there and help release that talent. What I'm really doing is say, perhaps the most important thing you could do throughout this technological transition period would be to take on the job of teaching, of taking what it is you have and very few other people on the planet have out to those people. One of the few jobs I believe worth doing. Anyway, that's my 10 cents worth. I believe we're about to go through the most comprehensive technology-driven change since Gutenberg invented the printing press, and if history is anything to go by, the institutions are only going to adapt with great reluctance. How you get them to adapt will dictate what America's position in the world is by the time you are all CEOs and presidents and professors. Let me end with a short tale from my own career that explains why I have this rather Pollyanna optimistic view of you Yanks. Many years ago, as you heard in the very nice introduction, I covered the Apollo mission for the BBC when you people went to the moon. Well, some of you went to the moon. And I gather from one of your lecturers, some of you didn't go to the moon. Anyway, one of the things that my mandate was from the BBC was to go to Houston and the Cape and so on and find out why Americans kept doing this. I mean, it was always the same, you know, come back, you know, go up, come back. So our job, excuse me, was to go and live with the engineers and the astrophysicists and so on and find out what was different about each mission. Come back and tell that story to our audience. I think that mandate was probably why we got high audiences right the way through all the missions, because every mission was entirely different. Anyway, one of the things in which I failed my mission, which is to explain, was when I came across a thing called a cuff checklist. I don't know if you've noticed, they still use them now on the shuttle when they're out doing EVAs. The cuff checklist on the moon was a kind of ring binder device, looked like a notebook, but the sheets were small sheets of plastic, and on these sheets were printed certain instructions. Now, the instructions were there for the following reason. When you are out on the surface of the moon, you have this much oxygen and this much work. There isn't that much oxygen, so you've got to get it right first time. The other reason is, as people have said in the past, while you're on the surface of the moon doing what you're doing, billions of people are watching you, so you better get it right. So on occasion, when you put down the white-hot piece of technology on which some poor slob of a scientist has spent his or her entire adult life, press the button and it doesn't work, what do you do? So these cuff checklists are written by the PI, the principal investigator, back in the science room in Houston, and understood only by that person and that astronaut, not the other astronaut. That one's got his own problems. Well, this is where I failed entirely, because here's an example. They all began with the name of the experiment, and then it would say, if there's a problem, go through the following repair attempt procedures. Number one, squelch the PCM lockout to 25.3, and then number two, even more complicated. By the time you got to about number six, it was total gobbledygook, and since number one was total gobbledygook, it didn't help. However, right at the end of each of these lists, designed to stave off the possibility of some kind of PR disaster on the surface of the moon, 240,000 miles from the nearest workbench, right at the end of each list came a line, an instruction from NASA, that made me feel that somehow America will always know what to do about the technology which she creates in order to make tomorrow better than today. Because at the end of each list of incredibly complex gobbledygook instructions, it said, if all other technological repair options to this point have failed, kick with a lunar boot. It's just that applause, I can run applause on a record of applause some other time, but I just thought maybe since there's not very much time, you might have one or two questions that I can't answer. So here's the, can we have the lights up, do you think? Here's the rules. If you have a question, raise a finger, and if you look harmless, I'll pick you, and then I'll revoice your question to my own advantage and duck it. And you may wish to shout, in which case I'll repeat the question, revoicing it, or you may wish to come to the microphone at the front. Nobody has the nerve. Ah, yes, an adult. Yes, sir.
Can you tell us, have you ever been approached by some kind of investor group that wants to develop the products that you predict will be necessary for the future, so they can get a jump on the whole process there?
Have I been approached by an entity willing to produce what I'm discussing so that people can use it to get a jump on the future? Well, kind of, yes, I have. I'm happy to say. I've developed a knowledge web, and this is why I'm saying I think it's a wonderful idea. But it's a very small knowledge web. It's only got about 1,500 nodes, each of one of which has four exit points, so it's quite large. I mean, much bigger than, it'll have to be online. I think all these things will have to be online. But there's growing interest in the information technology community to this kind of web building. It's a pity that the word web is being used, because we were using knowledge web a long time before WWW came up. So now everybody thinks we're using that concept, and we're not. But yes, there's considerable interest in it from the sort of Bill Gates of this world. Not yet from the educational community. Well, because I think, like everything else, they want to see it before they even accept that it might be possible to use. No more questions. Oh, sir.
Do you feel in general that history is being paid attention to, or is it sort of like every generation having to reinvent the wheel?
Do I think that history is being paid attention to, or does every generation have to start from scratch? Every generation has to start from scratch, I think. Thank heavens, otherwise history professors would be out of work, really, wouldn't they? I don't think we're very good at learning from history, no. I mean, look at Bosnia, for heaven's sake. No, not really. Yes, sir.
One of the potential problems I feel at least with web-based knowledge education is lack of sufficient depth in certain subject areas. And I was wondering how the problem would be.
Yes. The gentleman's problem, he says quite rightly, that this web approach to stuff is fine but superficial. And how would you handle that problem? Well, I mean, that's your opinion. I'll just give you my opinion. I'm not sure everybody else would agree with this. But the way I see it, the web, I see this kind of web as really, let's give it a three-dimensional feel. If you had yourself a gigantic sphere, which was formed of zillions and zillions of interconnecting, let's say, threads, for want of a better word, each thread being a series of events, necessary, right? And they interconnected and touched each other many, many millions of times over. And the ancient past was at the center of that sphere, and the modern world was on the outer surface of it, growing, of course, second by second, and becoming more dense second by second. Then as you travel this web, there ought to be ways to kind of go into wormholes. In other words, you would travel the web, and when you got to where it was you wanted to know more, you would go into a wormhole, and it would be a physics course, or a course in chemistry, or paleontology, or anything you liked. So what one would do in terms of making it would be to bolt in these kind of modules. Now the modules themselves might or might not be similarly interactive. They might be much more reductionist, straightforward. It would depend on the teaching community what they were. I'll say no more than that. The thing about this stuff is, if you don't mind me saying so, it's a tremendous threat to teachers. I mean, if you give kids this stuff, they come back with real problems. I mean, you know, you're going to have to work 7 weeks every week just to stay awake, as stay up with these people, because what you're inviting them to do is to go out there and think, sorry, I didn't mean this rudely, to think for themselves. To come back having thought imaginatively about how to put data together in different ways than you maybe as a teacher ever thought of. Now, to answer, to critique that stuff, maybe that means that you have to do a great deal more work than you have at the moment. And again, I'm not speaking about the people in this room, but I know plenty of teachers, my pals, who have taught this book for 20 years, you know, they know every dot and comma. And they don't want this to happen at all, because it makes life very difficult. Sorry, long answer. Yes, sir.
I have two of your books with me, and I wonder if you have time.
Of course. Black mark on paper, yes, I can do that. With great pleasure, and thank you for buying them. My publisher thanks you. Sir.
At the very beginning, the person up there mentioned that you are working on a new series. Could you say something about that?
Yes. Am I working on a new series? Yes. I can tell you that it's not called Journeys on the Web. It's called Connection 3. Nothing to do with me. I mean, discovery people say, if you change the brand image, people don't know what it is. You know, it's like selling a bottle of scotch but not mentioning that it's scotch. So they said, we have to call it Connections, otherwise nobody will know it's your work. Well, okay, fine. I mean, I don't care what it's called. I'm in the middle of it. It's 10 one-hours. Watch it, you'll never have insomnia again. What can I tell you about it that's different from the others? Well, it's an attempt to do what I described in a little way today. Program one begins, as it happened, in an Indian village. And each program begins where the last one left off. And the final program ends back in the Indian village. So it's a kind of giant loop, because that's what I consider as a knowledge web essentially to be. I mean, a million loops, but a loop. So that's the difference between it and the others. Each program stands on its own. Each program is equally boring, so if you only see one, it doesn't matter. But all 10, I think, should tell you something 10 times more boring than one. Way at the back, yes. Yes, you, sir, yes. And then the gentleman behind you, yes. After you. Up. You're right, yes. The effect of biotechnology and genetic manipulation vis-a-vis information technology. I tell you what I think, it's going to get very interesting when they both get together. And there's some interesting work being done right now, isn't there, in terms of new switching systems which are in effect organic. What else would you have me say? I'm only worried about one thing, and that is a magazine in America about 7 or 8 years ago ran a series of questions asking women if they had a choice in the physical attributes of their baby, what would it be? The vast majority of them said they wanted blue-eyed sons. Next down, they said brown-eyed sons. Next one was green-eyed sons. The next one was any color eye sons. So we have a problem immediately, don't we? See what I mean? I mean, that's what bothers me slightly, that ability to use genetic engineering to do more than make sure somebody is not born with some kind of impairment, but to move on to make sure that somebody is born with certain attributes that you think are valuable. I think diversity is extremely important to us, and I believe that one of the, if there is a threat posed, and it may not be posed, because it's a social decision, if there is a threat posed, it's the threat of genetic conformity that I've just described. And I believe it's clear that the safest thing you can be on the planet is diverse, which is why I'm happy that information technology is going to, I hope, cause all those other cultures to come up and be valid in their own terms, you know, just before the entire world was turned into one giant McDonald's. I mean, we did it before you did. I'm not attacking you at all. But so, I mean, diversity is the best thing to be, and I think that's a major threat that I would worry about in terms of bioengineering. Gentleman behind you. The problem, the gentleman asked me, what my view of change for change's sake. The problem about regulating change in any form, I mean, it's a chicken and egg, or I can't remember what metaphor to use here, so I won't use any. I mean, the problem you're postulating there is there such a thing as change for change's sake? Well, yes, I think probably commercially speaking, there's tons of it. Yes, I mean, I'm not sure I need a car that tells me in 27 languages that my perfume has run out in the car. Not sure I need that. I'm over generalizing this problem, you understand, but I mean, I think a great deal of commercial innovation happens because people want to make money. Fine. On the other hand, if you introduce any kind of regulation, what do you decide you don't want before it's been invented? Because cutting a road off now, I mean, the number of routes down which innovation has gone, which appeared utterly pointless at the beginning, ended up with something incredibly important. So if you cut that route off now because of some short-sighted, short-term, possibly political view of what should or shouldn't be done, who knows, as we say in British, you may be throwing out the baby with the bathwater. I'm a great believer in the fact that all of us in this room, acting as it were as a collective, will make a decision that is pretty good for 99% of us, right? All right, 90. And that's why I look to the day when one of the changes we're discussing here is the kind of change that this system, this institution here, will be able to poison the rest of the system with. That is to say, to teach people to think in this way so that they can access what it is necessary to make these decisions themselves rather than have the decisions made by, forgive me if you're in the room, what I would call unrepresentative representatives. I mean, there's no way that my representative can represent me. He doesn't know me, you know. And all the immense idiosyncrasy of my 100 billion neurons, or yours, or anybody else in this room. So I believe that the technology itself will aid us to find a way to achieve some kind of balance between socially responsible change and change for the sake of keeping people in jobs and helping people to be better off and have better holidays and all those other kind of vulgar things. I think I should stop in a minute, is that right? I can't see my mentor. Yes, I should stop. Okay, one more. Yes, thanks.
What do you see educational curriculum and the whole, you know, institution of education looking like here?
Oh boy. What do I see the educational curriculum looking like? This is a really dangerous thing to ask a guy. However, I can catch a plane and leave, can't I? Virtual for a start. Virtual. In most cases, I believe, especially in the third world, but certainly in parts of Alaska and parts of the 48, there are many, many, many people who are not benefiting from what you guys are benefiting from because they haven't got the professors that you've got, they haven't got the facilities you've got, and so on. So I would say virtuality, distance learning at the beginning. I suppose after that, you're asking the curriculum. You see, this is very difficult because I don't do this. I think, as I said during my speech, I really would like, whether I do it or somebody else does it, I really would like to see, and I think you're probably doing it here, I'd like to see people coming into their educational experience learning above all how things relate to each other, how all knowledge is interrelated, so that what somebody else is doing has something to do with you. Because ultimately we all live in a society where what everybody else does has something to do with me. As a poet said, no man is an island, you know. We all live with each other. And you know, whether somebody shares your opinion or whether somebody does something that you consider menial or whatever, it is an essential and valuable part of your community. And this approach to education starts you right off from the very beginning, looking at what it is you want to do in life and seeing it as part of a larger whole. So I suppose that's really as far as I'd want to go. Whether or not you should stop teaching people quantum chromodynamics is a very difficult problem. Because I suppose gradually you could say the real talent human beings have is not for the grunt work, and that most of science and technology up to now, boy, especially DNA work, is grunt work. It's hours and hours and hours and hours and hours of the kind of work that machines will do much better, much faster, much more efficiently, leaving us to do what we're really most talented at, using our imaginations. And I believe that the use of knowledge webs will help us practice the use of the imagination in that way, and I think could be very valuable. And that's all I have to say. Thank you.
Wow. You do it. At this time, I'd like Mr. Burke to please step up to the podium to accept a gift from IMSA.
Oh, a present.
Yes.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
On behalf of the Academy, I want to thank Mr. Burke for sharing his ideas with us. Thank you for spending time with us today. You are somebody that we all look up to for the innovation of your thoughts and, to be honest, your sense of humor that you use to make learning truly interesting. Once again, thank you to all of our visitors and guests for coming to IMSA. For our media guests today, a press conference will now be held next door in the West Gym. Thanks again, and have a good day.